Okay, so here we've got our beloved sea turtle, which we'll be using as an example for our node editing tutorial. So this will be our example object, which we'll be using for explaining the node editor. So if I go and pause the animation, let's say here, bring in our little sea turtle into the live viewer. Here we've got our sea turtle. So let's say we want to texture this thing and apply some materials. Here we've got our diffuse, our roughness, our specular, our bump, and our normal. And in this case, if I open up the node editor here, you can see I've got multiple channels. I've got four different channels for four different textures for the four different channels to apply these things in. But let's say we didn't have the normal map, so let's delete that. We didn't have the roughness and we didn't have the specular. So now here you can see the roughness, specular, normal map's gone. And all we had was this diffuse map. So now what we want to do is use this diffuse map to create a fake cheat, not a fake, but a very cheap way of creating bump map, specular map, and roughness map just using the diffuse map, because diffuse maps tends to have things like shadow information and stuff like that in it. So if we go and locate this image, for example, here you can see it tends to have shadow information for where the grooves are and where the highest points on a texture will be, and you can use that to translate into which part should be reflective on your specular, which part should have rough reflections, and which part should be bumpy, which part should be smooth, and you can generally try and fake it that way. So if you would want to use this one material to affect all these, one way is you could just take this, copy, paste it, and then in here you could try and go like and create RGB spectrum. So no, sorry, color correction. You could try do this and then remove the saturation and then adjust the gamma and stuff like that, and then you can go copy paste this thing to the roughness and all that. But now let's say you want to swap out the diffuse map for something else. Let's say you swap this out. The issue now is that these won't update. Now you can go and swap it out a different way by swapping out these materials, and that'll update universally. But let's say you don't want to do that for whatever reason, and you want one material here or one texture here to control all the other textures that are identical, so that they all update individually. So you'll need to do that in the node editor, because node editor is just, it's a lot better for doing that. So here, if we go into the node editor, what you can actually do is here you have your same materials. Here we have our color corrections you've done. You can go and delete these, delete that, and you can apply this individual texture into different specular roughness maps and stuff like that. So here you can go put in the specular, roughness, and bump. So now we have one texture that's controlling all of these. So for example, if I go and swap this out for something else like this material, here you can see that they've all gone and updated in this situation. So this is where the node editor can become very useful, and a lot of people use it for all their editing. I don't often use it, just because, but that's just the type of work that I do that doesn't often need as complex materials. But in situations where it does get a bit more complex, let's say I do like a lot of products, so packaging labels that need some areas to be transparent, some areas to be reflective, some areas to have metallic materials and stuff like that all in one texture, that's where this, I might pull this out. So another useful situation here is you can now go and put in like a color correction here for your specular and color correction for your roughness, and then the same for your bump map. So here, so bump, specular, roughness. So specular materials tends to be black and white. You can have a colored speculum texture, because you can have a colored specular texture, because things like gold and stuff can have a colored reflection. So you can have a colored specular, but generally they're generally black and white. A lot of situations that I'm making up gold material and stuff, my specular will have a color in it. Roughness is black and white because you're only defining the value of how rough something is, which is between 0 and 1, which is basically between 0, different grayscales, and white. Between black, different grayscales, and white. So this will be black and white. Same with the bump map. So the bump map only defines up and down, basically height, which is very similar to a displacement map. A displacement map, you can think of a bump map as a bump map on steroids. So a bump map is only black and white because it only defines up and down. And that's where a normal map becomes different, because a normal map defines up, down, and also another direction, which is basically sideways. So normal maps tend to be smoother, have more detail in them, because it has an extra direction and it's not just up and down like that. So bump maps are also black and white. And so are displacement maps. The advanced version is a displacement map actually displaces the geometry, rather than just faking it through bumps and stuff like that. You can just think of it as a bump map on steroids. So here you've got that. And now let's say you want to go and control how bumpy it is and stuff. You can either control it in here. So here you can remove the brightness there and adjust the brightness here, adjust the hue, gamma, whatever you want to do. And now if you want to go and swap out this material, you can just go do that, swap it out, and now it goes and updates on all these other sections here as well. So this is where the node editor can become very useful. So I've got projects which have huge node editing systems as well, which I'll show you an example of now, and that's where you can start to use other things down here. So this is an example of what a complicated node system might look like. It's a bit of an old project from a year and a half ago. And it shows how you can actually use the node editor to create complex materials. So a lot of these materials on this project are actually missing. So that's why you'll see some of these spaces, a lot of these spaces actually are black. Just because the materials are missing and I'm not in the mood to go find them. So here, I'm sure you might see other people have projects that look like this as well, and you might be wondering what's going on. It's very, very basic. So here we've got our master material, so our final material, which is our one of a mix materials, and I'm not here to explain how all the materials work and stuff, but here we've got a mix material, and inside that we've got two mix materials, we've got one mix material and one overlay, and here you can kind of see how it goes down like a tree. So if we start down here, we've got a dirt map with a gradient to define how rough the dirt map is. We've got subtract nodes to mix these two together. Then we've got another gradient, and then here we've got an add node, which mixes these two together, and then it just keeps going up, and they're just kind of mixing things together, mixing and matching things together to layer different parts of the material on all the way up to the top here. So if I go and look at the final render, here you can see what this final result looks like. It's a hockey puck. I used to be big into ice skating, and I went and made a hockey puck for a ice rink that I would ice skate at. And here you can kind of see how I've gone and turned this image here. If I could do this without opening Photoshop, that would be great. View, extra large icons. Here you can see we've got this image icon, which is a Photoshop file of the World Championship logo. And I've gone and mixed different materials inside here to give it some scratches and add some fingerprints and add some dirt and scratch marks and all sorts of layers that go on top of each other, which is basically what's going on here. And it's all layered up all the way down onto and then supplied to this object here, which is just a cylinder basically. And you get this very realistic looking hockey puck because of the layered materials and textures that are applied together and mixed together to give you something like this. So hence the node editor like this. So I've got like a lot of tutorials on YouTube on how to layer texture together. When I was starting out with Octane, that was a lot of what I was doing, is just making things look real. So a lot of my older tutorials dive into mixing materials and creating scratches and bumps and dirts and all that and making things look photorealistic. These days, it's actually dialed back a lot more because it's not so much about making things look real anymore. Depending on what the client's needs are and stuff, it's more about just making sure that the client gets what they need and stuff like that. So, yeah, so that's where this is a situation where I'll use the node editor because it'll be impossible to. Every time you want to change something, you have to go through all these individual channels. You don't know where things are. If you want to swap this out, now you have to go back to this other material. And like here, there's like five different materials, which are all interlocked into one. And you definitely need a node editor like this to help organize things and make things easier. So if I want this image texture to now be plugged into there, you can simply just go drag and drop. And it's simple as that. And in this case, it's not letting me, but you can kind of see, it's just an example. So here, yeah, so in this situation, here's where a node editor will be useful. You can just take one material and apply it to different, to control different things. And here you can see how you can have a very complex system of a spider web of materials and stuff like that. And yeah, so on the side here, it basically shows you all the different things you can add as well. Noise shaders, multiply nodes, all sorts of stuff like that. If you really want to know what all these things do, you can read the Octane manual. They have a website. Octane has a website with their manual, which explains every single one of these things. And yeah, it's pretty simple. I hope you guys enjoyed the tutorial and learned something. This is a very long requested tutorial, so hopefully this was a good enough explanation for you guys.